Hello and welcome to a special interview for The Wire, supported by Glenlivet Books. My guest today is undoubtedly one of India's most highly distinguished and best-known human rights activists, Harsh Mandir. 5 days ago, Harsh Mandir published his recent book, and here it is. It's called Locking Down the Poor, and it's a stinging critique of the way COVID-19 has been handled by the Modi government. But before I talk to Harsh Mandir about his book, I want to talk to him about the harrowing experience he's had in hospital. Harsh Mandir, in October you got COVID-19 and you deliberately chose to admit yourself to the general ward of a public hospital. You say, what I experienced there is as close to hell as I can imagine. I am not exaggerating. Tell me, what happened?
Since I was on the streets from almost the second day, I was expecting to get, I had bargained for getting COVID, but I had to be with the homeless. It was several months later that I actually caught COVID when we started a clinic for the homeless. And very quickly, my whole family got COVID. My mother-in-law is 85 and my wife. And I became increasingly anxious that if something happened to me, my family would be in deep trouble. And so I decided to check myself into a hospital so that, because I have a congenital heart problem. So I thought it would save my family trouble if I went into a public hospital. But I did not want to go into an expensive hospital. I said I'd go into a public hospital, and there, again, my conscience troubled me with the idea of seeking a private room because I what my book is about is how much ordinary people have suffered. And I said, I agree to go into your hospital, but I want to be in a public ward. And I go into this premier hospital and I couldn't believe what happened there. And so very briefly, I went in, there was total chaos. There were about 50 beds. Nobody gave me even a change of clothes. So whatever I was wearing, they said, just lie down. There was a monitor which was making a lot of noise, but it wasn't working. So at home, at least somebody was checking my oxygen. Yeah, nobody was doing any of that. The noise levels of the nurses and the ward boys was, high pitch, even at 2 o'clock at night, 3 o'clock at night. The monitors were screaming. And patients, there were at least half a dozen patients among the 50 who thought they were about to die. Families were not allowed. And they were lamenting and screaming about their sadness about dying. And all of this was sort of going on all around us. Nobody was, I started talking to the ward boys. I like to do that. And I discovered that most of them were untrained. And they said that, I worked in a hospital, in a hotel as a room boy in Connaught Place. The hotel closed down. My family was starving. The regular staff of the hospital, many of them just refused to work in a COVID ward. So it was left to people who were desperate. They just said, come in. Most of them were almost completely untrained. And so you were surrounded by this set of people who were untrained. There was total chaos. It was unbelievable. And and I kept wondering, and no one was checking if my oxygen had gone down. I would have, there was no way anyone would know. So it was really, and for that happening in the capital city, in a very major hospital, I'd heard stories very similar to this from homeless people. And they said things even much worse, that if somebody actually died, fortunately it didn't happen, they wouldn't be willing to pick up the corpse. So you'd be surrounded sometimes by corpses of people dead. And if the patients made too much of a noise about it, then they said, you pick up the corpses. We won't touch them.
In an interview that you gave Natasha Badwar, you said most of the people in the ward you were in were panic-stricken, they were going to die. Visitors were not allowed. Patients were not even allowed to go to the loo themselves. Yes. And you said most people were crying because they were scared they were going to die. When I read it, I said, this sounds like a nightmare.
Yes. And it was an unending nightmare. Even at night, 1 o'clock, 2 o'clock, 3 o'clock at night, the noise, the wailing, all of this was continuing, and it was so uncaring. It just represented to me what we have brought our public systems to. I mean, if this is the best of our public systems, then what would be the poor in a small town in Bihar?
Tell me, Harsh, what was the name of this hospital?
I'm holding it back.
But why? Deliberately. Why? Surely this is something the Indian public have a right to know.
Okay, it was the All India Institute of Medical Sciences.
That is the premier hospital of the country.
Yes.
I mean, forgive me. All India Institute of Medical Sciences is considered the best hospital in the country, particularly when one is seriously ill. And you just recounted a harrowing experience where the ward boys had no training. They actually were hotel boys looking for a job. Patients were uncared for. Monitors were not working. Oxygen wasn't checked. People weren't allowed to go to the loo, and patients were panic-stricken and no one cared. And this happened in the premier hospital of the country.
That's absolutely right. Every word of what you said is right.
Now, something else happened which is very surprising, and it was for you very harrowing. You suddenly lost your memory and it was gone for 10 days. Mm-hmm. Tell me about that.
So, you know, after a day, I don't remember exactly how much time passed, but I was sleeping in the same clothes I'd come in. You were not allowed to change. You know, you didn't bring in any clothes and they didn't give you a set of hospital clothes. So I begged them that at least, like, can I have a bath? And so finally they agreed. They took me into a room and they said, okay, you can have a bath. And from then I've lost memory completely. So what my family tells me is that I stopped speaking, and they used to call me on the phone. I just wouldn't answer. So they started worrying, what has happened to him? So the hospital staff said he's suddenly gone into a depression. So they said it's not his temperament to go into a depression. And even if one does, one, it isn't that half an hour earlier you're talking, lying to a dozen, and suddenly you switch off completely. Something has happened to him. Nothing has happened to him. So after a day or so, they decided to get me discharged. In the discharge, they said that his COVID symptoms are under control. All his parameters are okay. He's going for home isolation. They didn't mention anything else. I come home. My wife and my daughter were presented to me. They asked me who they were. Fortunately, I remember their names. And they said, who are they? I said, they're nurses. And I wouldn't eat. I wouldn't speak. And this went on for 3 or 4 days. Nobody could understand what was happening. On the fourth or fifth day, I developed blue marks on my forehead like a namazi. And this was all internal bleeding that was happening. And they'd given me blood thinners, which actually were increasing the bleeding. So about 6 days or 7 days after whatever happened to me, they finally admitted me into a modest private hospital. I wasn't there to be able to protest. And they took me in, and in a day they said, there's nothing about COVID that is there to worry, but he's got a very serious brain injury and he can die. We don't have the facilities to take care of him. Go and find another hospital. So where should we take him? Take him to Max, take him to Medanta. My family said he won't forgive us if we do that. So they found a modest hospital called Narayana in Gurgaon, which finally agreed to admit me. They admitted me into a ward which had 100 people. And slowly my memory started coming back. And it was even worse than, you know, it was what I saw in All India Institute.
Doctor, let me stop you there. You say that when you got examined at a private hospital and they did MRI scans, they discovered extensive brain damage and internal bleeding. And your last memory at Ames is when you went for a bath, and presumably your last memory is in the bathroom. Did something happen in the bathroom of that general ward in that public hospital which caused this injury? Do you have any memory at all of being hit or falling down and getting hurt? Were you attacked, or could it have been an accident?
What the doctor says that this is a mystery very hard to solve, because the extraordinary thing is I don't even have a scratch in my head. I mean, suppose I had fallen, suppose I'd fallen, hit my head against something, there would have been an external wound, and then there would have been internal injuries as well. Here I was without a single scratch on my head, showing no injury. And inside the brain, they said it is damaged in multiple ways all over, you know, the lobes, etc. And even now, I'm 2 days ago, I again saw one of the country's leading neurologists here, my friends insisted. And he said that you're alive is a miracle. That you heal so much is a miracle. And somebody told me they look at my MRI, the first MRI, which was 7 days after the incident happened. And they say, it's incredible that you're alive. And if I had died, it would have simply been marked out as one more COVID death.
Absolutely. That is the shocking part, that the doctors look at your MRI and wonder how it is that you're alive. I gather the doctors even wonder why your personality hasn't changed, because the injury was so serious and severe. And this means that if your wife hadn't panicked when she discovered that you lost your memory, you weren't ringing, and discharged you from Ames, you would have died in Ames, and you would have been recorded wrongly as just another COVID death.
Absolutely. So what the doctor says that they gave me blood thinner, so the bleeding was even greater. And then they said,
were they giving the blood thinners after this injury happened?
I mean, I was taking blood thinners earlier, so they continued them because they said nothing's wrong with you. And then they say that part of your lobe actually affects your personality, and most people would become much more aggressive and selfish. My very dear friends who were sitting in said, we wish that would have happened a little bit to make life easier for us to handle you. But luckily none of that happened.
This suggests to me that Ames is guilty of gross negligence. First of all, you were appallingly treated as every other patient was in that ward, neglected, not cared for, not looked after. An injury clearly happened, but the doctors in the hospital didn't notice it. Worse still, they claimed it was depression. Wouldn't accept from your wife that no one goes into depression so quickly. And then, most importantly of all, let you continue with blood thinners without realizing this was endangering you further. Would you accept this is gross negligence by Ames?
I think it is at least, you know, at the very least, it is gross negligence, which could have led to my death, according to all doctors. But what is frightening is the fact that I have this extensive brain damage with no external injuries while I'm sitting in a public hospital, which no one acknowledges. I mean, it's terrifying in multiple ways. I in this interview as well, and even when I spoke once earlier, I'm only anxious that the issue is not what happened to me. The issue is that this is what is happening to people. You know, if this happens in our premier hospital to somebody who has a fair amount of social capital, then what would be happening to a poor person in small public hospitals across the country?
Absolutely. The vast majority, 90-95% of our countrymen, if they fall ill, whether it's COVID or something else, and if they need hospitalization, it's a public hospital they would go to. And most would strive to go to Ames because of the belief it is the premier hospital of the country. You're suggesting that what you've gone through is likely to be the experience they will face as well. This is the level of treatment and care made available at Ames.
In fact, it would be, the best that they could experience is what I experienced. It's likely to be far, far worse. And I've heard many testimonies. I've recorded them in my book itself. You know, I think it's a wake-up call, and I'm very keen that we move away from me into what...
Oh, I will. But tell me this. Did you raise with Ames, with the management, the way you were treated? Have you formally said to them, this was gross negligence and I could have died if my wife hadn't discharged me herself?
In fact, I've just been recovering, but I was struggling with whether I should name Ames at all. And Karan, really the reason is that I don't want me to be the focus of this discussion. I
mean, it won't be. But the point is this, if you don't raise formally with AIIMS what happened,
yes,
and you don't use your influence to tell them that if this continues, then they will be taken to court or to the government, this will continue. It's in the interest of the Indian people that you should formally raise with AIIMS and demand an explanation and apology. Have you done that?
I haven't done that, and maybe I'm wrong to not to have done it, and I need to consider it. I repeatedly say that I think, you know, when somebody with social capital from the middle class suffers, it becomes something that we all discuss. You know, homeless people were telling me about their experiences in public hospitals. And if you're homeless and Muslim, then...
Harsh, I'm interrupting you again. It's because you have social capital that you can, by raising this, try and correct it. That's in the interest of those who are poor and don't have that capital. Hence my question, which I repeat. Will you now raise this so that pressure is brought on AIIMS to correct and improve?
I've been thinking, actually, the last few days that I would raise the conditions of the hospital, certainly, formally, with the AIIMS director. My head injury and the brain injury and the mystery around it, I also think I probably should raise it, because it is frightening what could have happened. And the fact that I've seen videos of the right wing about how you can kill somebody without leaving any evidence. And this was with no external injury, you have this degree of brain damage. I read the MRI reports. I mean, even as a lay person, it's frightening. It goes on to 1.5 pages. It describes this damage here, this damage here, this damage here. What happened? And then I've asked many doctors, they say it's got nothing to do with COVID. This is not what COVID does to you.
This is why it is essential to raise it. Two more questions before I turn to your book. God forbid you should ever fall seriously ill again and require hospitalization. Will you still insist upon going to the general ward of a public hospital? Or now, after this experience, will you accept what your family undoubtedly will be pushing for, private treatment?
See, it is a moral dilemma. Now, life is full of these very difficult moral dilemmas. As long as I was a civil servant and a district magistrate, I used to insist that I would always go only to a government hospital. And this was 20, 30 years ago, and conditions were really bad. I just to tell you very briefly a story, I had to get a tooth pulled out. And I go into this place, the dentist chair was, it was rusty, it was dirty. The doctor was clearly nervous, and before he started taking it out, he did a prayer and made me even more nervous. And then he started pulling out, and he got bits of my jaw out. It was the most painful thing I experienced. My jaw locked for 15 days because of the pain. But I still feel that I did the right thing to go to him rather than choose the easy way out and go to a private dentist, because we are public servants.
Are you saying that now if you fall ill again, you will still go to the general ward of a public hospital?
I think that is what I should do.
But what will you do?
We'll have to struggle with that. But certainly if I was the minister, if I was the home minister in charge at the national level, or if I was the health minister, I mean, and chief ministers, it's shameful that they check in as soon as they got infected with COVID into the most expensive private hospitals, rather than trusting public system where they would have been treated as VIPs and they would have got the best treatment. I mean, I think that we have just abandoned, and I would be complicit in that.
I'm stopping you there because I want to pick up and I want you to elaborate on the point you made. You're saying it's shameful that the Home Minister, Amit Shah, it's shameful that several cabinet ministers, it's shameful that several chief ministers, when they got COVID, deliberately chose to check into expensive private hospitals, ignoring government-owned public hospitals. It's shameful, you're saying.
It's not only shame. I mean, it's shameful beyond description because, you know, you are in government in order to ensure, and this is the worst health emergency in a century. And you don't trust your own public hospitals. When I wrote my book, I mean, even I didn't know that 80% of our trained workforce work for the private sector, for profit, which is only 20% who work for public hospitals. Now, it was the private hospitals did less, and the most charitable estimates is that they contribute about 10% to the anti-COVID, but I think it was more about looking after people who...
But before we go into that distinction between private and public, you're sticking to this. It's shameful beyond description that the Home Minister, Chief Minister, Cabinet Ministers chose private treatment.
You see, if you're an office, in order to ensure the care in public hospitals of people who are suffering from this pandemic, but you yourself don't trust your life there.
Okay.
That means that my life is important, and I will protect it by going to the most expensive private hospital. Your life doesn't matter. That's what you're conveying.
Okay, that's very, very clear. Let's now move beyond that harrowing, nightmarish experience you had at Ames. And it's particularly shocking that it should have happened at what we consider the premier hospital of the country. And I'm glad that you will raise this with the director, and you'll additionally consider raising your personal injury as well. Let's now turn to your book. I'm holding it up yet again. Here it is. It's called Knocking Down the Poor. And as I said in the introduction, it is a stinging criticism of the 60-day lockdown imposed by Mr. Modi at just about 4 days' notice. You say, and I'm quoting, the lockdown was a crime against the people of India. It is, and it must be recognized to be, a crime against humanity. I don't think anyone has ever used such strong language. I don't believe anyone has called it a crime. So let me ask you, how do you justify that word crime? Most people would be a little shocked and shaken that you've used it.
I've used the word very, very thoughtfully and advisedly. I've said, in fact, I believe it's not one crime, but multiple crimes against humanity. And just give me 2 or 3 minutes to try to explain some aspects of this crime. We compare ourselves, say, with Pakistan and China, for instance. China, even at its peak, locked down just 5% of its population. We locked down 100% of our population. Mr. Imran Khan, President Imran Khan, he is somebody we rightly, call a playboy and, you know, an elite guy. When he was advised to go ahead with a lockdown of the kind, he used words which I still recall. He said that if we were a rich industrialized country, if people had social security, if people had homes, we might have considered it. But he said, what will happen to my poor people? He used the word my poor people. When I know that they eat what they earn every day, they don't have homes. If we have a lockdown, they will be devastated.
Is that what you're making, Harsh Mandir, that the lockdown ignored the vast majority of India's people who are poor, who cannot eat if they don't earn, and they were driven to the wall by hunger? Is that why you say it was a crime? Can you explain that word crime?
Yeah, I'll explain it, precisely. And but that's only one part of it, but it's a very important part. You know, when the Prime Minister announced the lockdown, I was sitting in front of the TV screen, as most of us were. And I was amazed because he was saying 4 things. He said, stay within your homes, work from home, keep social distance, wash your hands regularly. And I'm saying, this is the Prime Minister of this country. Does he not remember that there are large numbers of people, especially in cities, who don't even have homes, or people whose homes are so small, they're living in shanties. If 8-10 people are living in a small shanty, 100 people sharing a toilet with 100 people, how are they ever going to keep social distance? Where they spend a third or a quarter of their income to buy one pot of water, they don't have running water, how are they going to wash their hands? So clearly, even the design of the lockdown, and this is something I want to really underline, even the design of the lockdown actually excluded the large majority of India's people. It was designed to protect people who had homes, who would get income, who would get incomes even if they stayed at home, who can keep social distance.
The points you're making are well known. They were written about extensively as soon as the lockdown was declared, that it ignored the conditions in which the poor lived. It ignored the fact that most people live 10 or 12 per room, don't have running water, can't wash their hands. Comments were made also about the fact that PM told people to walk onto their balconies and ring and bang utensils to praise our COVID warriors when people don't have balconies. All of that is known. But why do you call it a crime? That's very harsh language. Explain that. Why is it a crime?
You see, because please remember that in human history, we had the harshest, biggest lockdown, not just now, ever in human history. We overnight closed down all of demand and all of supply. In a country where 9 out of 10 people are informal workers and would not be able to get 9 out of 10 people would not be able to earn and eat the next day. We had the smallest relief package. Prabhat Patnaik, Jyoti Ghosh and I wrote a number of articles saying that at the very least, in the middle class, we are getting our salaries. You have to then ensure minimum wages is paid to every single person.
Again, these are points that are known. You're saying, therefore, it's a crime because the design excluded the enormous cost that would be paid by the poor. It ignored the fact that there was no way that they could actually live if they weren't earning and no one gave them a sufficient money to carry on, and so they were driven to starvation. All of this together.
It was a crime for some certain other reasons as well. Sorry to interrupt.
But very quickly, explain to me very quickly.
So, because of this, the economy is devastated. We're going into our first contraction. We don't even know what a contraction is going to mean in terms of, you read John Steinbeck's Grapes of Wrath and see what happened in the Great Depression. We're pushing probably for several years our poor people into a situation of chronic mass hunger of the kind I've never seen in cities. I've worked with the homeless for the last 20 years. I've never seen hunger of this scale. We shame them into actually getting into line for 2 kilometers for most of the day to get one plop of food. And all of this has happened. If all of this happened, the justification was we would build our health infrastructure. That didn't happen. I mean, the situation that I described.
Well, let me stop you there. I'm quoting what you say about that in your book. My fundamental objection to the policy of the lockdown in India is that it could never, even in the best implementation, have ensured safety from infection for the large mass of the poor. But actually, the lockdown wasn't really intended to ensure safety from infection. It was intended to buy time so that the health system could be prepared, so that we could acquire sufficient stocks of masks, of PPE equipment, of ventilators, so that when the worst happened, India was better prepared. Now, the government statistics suggest that actually a huge amount was done in terms of preparing the country with sufficient PPEs, with masks, with goggles, with the paraphernalia needed. You're questioning that.
I'm questioning that hugely, because primarily we were required to create a whole new infrastructure for this explosion of COVID patients that we would have. Our Prime Minister very often speaks with great economy of truth. I mean, I'm looking at a polite way of saying this. He announced that we have created 1 lakh new beds during the lockdown for COVID. It was not true. They just repurposed existing beds. So they said, these cancer ward, in Bombay, they actually took out the cancer patients from the cancer ward, put them under an overbridge and put mats. So those beds were now available.
Let me stop you. I know that the vast majority of beds were repurposed, to use the word you used, but have you forgotten the satsang facility created in Chhatarpur, which can house 10 or 15,000 patients? Similar facilities were also created in Bombay. So in addition to repurposing, surely there was new beds created. And before you answer, let me quote what Mr. Gadkari said. He said, India is now making 6 lakh PPE kits per day, and exporting them to countries like America, Canada, the Emirates, and many European countries. Separately, Piyush Goyal has said, India is exporting 40 million surgical masks and 2 million medical goggles each month. So in terms of beds, in terms of equipment, the lockdown did provide the government time to build up readiness so that when the worst hit, we were better prepared. Do you still dispute that?
I dispute. See, what did we really need? We needed, see, what did Spain do? I'm just giving you an example. 80% of our, in India, we have betted entirely on the private sector to provide health. And when people like us complained, they said, you'll all have health insurance. You can go and buy your healthcare. Government systems are inefficient. When this crisis really hit us, we found that 80% of India's trained health personnel work for the private sector for profit. And they more or less abandoned. I mean, the services they provided only about 10% of the services at very, very high inflated costs. So it was left to 20% of the health infrastructure and personnel to deal with the century's biggest health crisis. I would have immediately nationalized the private healthcare system as they did in Spain and in other countries.
Now, it's not that I'm refuting or disputing what you're saying. Maybe there is an argument for claiming we should have followed Spain and nationalized private healthcare for a limited period so that COVID could be taken care of. But I have to point out, I don't think you're fair in saying that the private hospitals ignored COVID completely. I got COVID. I didn't have to go to hospital, fortunately, but Max Healthcare took excellent care. And the charge was not very much. The total I paid for being in touch with Max Healthcare 3 or 4 times a day, including blood checks and CT scans, was roughly 24,000-25,000. So let's be honest, I think you're being a little unfair in being dismissive of private healthcare.
I'm absolutely not. I mean, you are Karan Thapar, and if you were not, what would have happened to you? I mean, I know people who have had to, even for PPE kits, they will add on, you know, highly inflated costs, the costs that they were charging patients. It was very hard to get into any of those hospitals. If you got into the hospitals, you had to pay very, very high bills. But this is not how a country deals with the biggest health crisis of the century. Okay. And even that 20% who are in the public health system, a large part of them also pushed back. I'm too old. I'm an ENT specialist. I don't have to do this. I mean, the situation I saw on the AIIMS board was because the people who should have been there were not there. They're not willing to work and put their lives at risk.
Now, that's very important point. You're saying doctors at AIIMS who should have been working in wards where people had COVID were not willing to work there because they didn't want to put their lives at risk. Now you're saying that doctors at AIIMS actually were not taking care of patients. It's a very important point.
I'm saying that doctors, nurses, the whole health system had to prioritize patients. You know, I have any number of testimonies, and I spent those first 6 months, a huge amount of my time talking to very poor people and so on. The kinds of stories they told us were horrifying. They said that it was hard enough to get into one of the public hospitals. If you were there, as I said, they would throw the medicine at you. They won't even want to touch you. If a patient died, the corpse would be next to you. They would ask the patients, if you have such a problem, you pick up the body and take it to the mortuary. We have treated our people so shamefully.
Let's take a wider
cumulatively the time.
We've gone into the details of how the lockdown was the wrong response. You call it a crime. We've gone into details about how the lockdown should have been used to build up the health service, but it wasn't done. You believe the Indian government should have done what Spain did, which is nationalize private healthcare for a limited period. You've also pointed out how even premier hospitals like AIIMS did not respond adequately. You make, however, an even bigger point about the lockdown. You say the lockdown was imposed to protect the well-off. Well, ironically, because they can travel, brought the virus to India. But the price and cost of the lockdown was paid by the poor. And your conclusion is, and I'm quoting you, the state drew clear lines between those who were to be saved and those who could be sacrificed, those whose lives mattered and those who were expendable. It seems to me, when I read that sentence, that you're almost accusing the government of calculated murder. In fact, It sounds almost genocide.
That is why I call it a crime against humanity. You know, the point, Karan, that I repeatedly need to underline is that many people say lockdown was necessary, it was not implemented well. I'm saying that the lockdown in a situation where 9 out of 10 people are informal workers, in a situation where large numbers don't have homes or live in shanties, there are parts, slums in India, which are supposed to be the densest populations in the planet. And a virus just loves closely packed, undernourished bodies because they've become hothouses for it to be expanded. You know, if we had responded humanely and we had recognized the situation, when there were just 500 recorded cases in the country, railways were carrying 23 million people a day.
But come back to the point you were almost answering before you deflected yourself. Do you agree that sentence I read out suggests that you're accusing the government of calculated murder? Some might say.
I'm saying yes, absolutely. I'm saying that they didn't murder them by actively murdering them. They murdered them by creating situations where the entire safety that they spoke about was safety that only the middle class and the rich could access. Then when the migrant crisis happened, people started saying this is happening to the poor. Again, the Prime Minister comes back to us and says, I appeal to employers and I appeal to landlords not to to pay their wages and so on. A government doesn't just appeal to an act of charity to protect millions of its people. And it had no provision when people did not do this.
Okay.
And a large number of the factories, I mean, you see, because we were distributing food. So initially it was the destitute and, you know, where there would be 1,000 people, you found 5,000, 10,000. They were sort of scrambling over each other. Then we started getting distress calls from industrial areas and because factories had closed. And those people were so ashamed. I mean, they would be standing. They said that we have never put our hands out like this for food. What have we been reduced?
But as you say, the lockdown stripped the poor of the one thing they had, dignity and self-respect. They were forced to stand 2 miles, 3 miles long in queues, dependent on charity. At this point, I want to go back to something you hinted at a moment ago. I want to raise it more explicitly. You make a very telling comparison between how COVID-19 was treated in India by Modi and how it was treated in Pakistan by Imran Khan. Not only do you say in your book, Pakistan benefited, ironically, because it refused to go in for a stringent lockdown, but you add, the playboy elite Imran Khan displayed much greater sensitivity and compassion for his working class fellow countrymen than did Narendra Modi. The BJP and the government is going to bristle with anger when you say that Pakistan handled COVID better than Narendra Modi.
Well, the figures show it. The figures show it. See, you can't argue with... You know, we could have argued about it 6 months ago. We can't argue with it now. The irony is that Bangladesh and Pakistan, let alone a country like Vietnam, etc., have had a much better control on COVID. And what is very interesting, the impact on the economy has been much less. They've not gone into contraction. They have slower rates of growth, but they still have growth. You know, I have long believed, even as a civil servant and as somebody who has advocated, that doing the humane and kind thing and for the poor is also good for the economy. You know, if they had given every poor person minimum wages 6,000 rupees from day one, as the middle class was getting, it would have cost us 3% of our GDP.
But come back to the comparison with Pakistan. You're saying Imran Khan handled COVID better than Modi.
I'm saying that Imran Khan, because he displayed elementary compassion, when he said, my people will not be able to eat if they don't get a chance to work, I cannot impose a lockdown, it would be too cruel. It was this clarity that has saved Pakistan, which is a very poorly governed state.
So you're saying if Imran Khan's policies had been followed in India, we would have come out of COVID better.
I'm saying that if the compassion that Imran Khan displayed was displayed by our leadership, and at the height of the hunger crisis, we see our prime minister dressing up in multiple kinds of fancy clothes and feeding peacocks. I mean, the display of insincerity.
But finish your sentence. You've deflected yourself again. Finish your sentence. If the compassion Imran Khan displayed had been displayed by our leadership, finish that sentence. What would have happened?
We would not have gone for the most drastic lockdown that the world has ever seen. We would have had a much larger relief package for the limited lockdown that we would have done. We would have enforced our private sector to actually contribute to public health and public service. We would have.
And would we have been better off?
Now it is no longer speculative. I mean, a country like Vietnam.
No, but answer the question about Pakistan. Let's not deflect to Vietnam. Would we have been better off if Imran Khan's policies had been followed in India?
I'm saying that even though it is such a poorly governed state, the fact that he did not at least do this negative sort of sledgehammer locking down completely thoughtlessly without relief, that has saved its people.
Just give me a straight answer, Harshmandir. Yes, we would have been better off if we had.
Yes, we would have been better off, even in even when we compare with a very poorly governed state like Pakistan, if elementary compassion had been.
Okay. I think
our leadership.
I think you're saying, and I'm only interpreting it, that yes, India would have been better off if India had followed Imran Khan's handling of COVID.
Yes.
Yes. Okay.
Of not having a lockdown, a stringent lockdown.
We are coming to the end of this interview. I've got just two questions. How do you respond to the argument that given the size and scale and complexity of India, a subcontinent with 1.3 billion people and a third world country to boot, India did as best as it could?
That's why I made the comparisons actually in that part of my book with the two countries we are hyphenated with. One of them is Pakistan, the other one of them is China. China, as I said, even at its peak, it invented the lockdown more or less. Even at its peak, it locked down just 5% of its population. It's not even a democracy. And its total number of infections, please underline this. The total number of infections that China has had through this entire period is now less than the number of infections we add every single day in India.
Can I again interrupt, Harsh? China's a different system, a different government, and we don't know how accurate are those Chinese statistics, either of total infections or death. You may accept them, but I need to point out to the audience that there are many who have raised serious questions about the accuracy and the verifiability of China. But my question was different. My question was...
In fact, many people, many foreigners who live there, I mean, if you had runaway deaths, if they were reporting completely false, we are testing so low. So obviously our figures are much, much lower than exist. Our testing per capita is one of the lowest. So we are hiding figures as well. But China certainly has brought things under control. And you keep interrupting me when I talk about Vietnam. Vietnam is a much poorer country. It has brought its infections almost down to zero. It has demonstrated. South Korea didn't even go in for a lockdown. It just had one policy, which was test, test, test. And you could go to a metro station, you could go to a bus stop. Anybody who wanted would get tested. As soon as you tested positive, they would quickly find your contacts.
They saying India could have done a lot better than it did.
It should not have gone in for a lockdown. It should have gone in for a very different kind of process, which was, the South Korean model of test, test, test.
And you don't accept the argument that given the size, scale, the subcontinental nature of the country, the 1.3 billion population, India did as well as it could. You don't accept that?
I think it did the worst that it could. And I'm really not overstating. I think that we are going to, for a generation at least, we're going to bear the consequences of these mistakes.
Okay.
And the human cost.
By putting this to you. Finally, in your book, you say of the lockdown that it, and I'm quoting you now, laid bare our broken society, the near complete estrangement of people of privilege from the working poor in India. Does that mean that the lockdown exposed India as a really rather nasty place?
It exposed people of privilege in India and the state as being some of the most uncaring people in the world. You know, it struck me that when the Prime Minister was making these announcements, why did the middle class not immediately react? What is going to happen to poor people? You know, and right through, he asked us to bang thalis. We banged our thalis without, again, when migrants were going out in the largest movement, distress movement in human history, greater than partition, only smaller than the slave trade. Why did we not react? I mean, I'll just give, you know, one example. When the students were picked up from Kota on these fancy buses, could we have had one student, just one student, who said, I refuse to get onto one of these buses and take this privilege until migrant workers in this country are given the same buses and the same services?
You're saying that the middle class let down India. You're saying the privilege cared only about themselves. They turned a complete blind eye to the poor. Selfishness trumped caring for your countrymen.
You know, Ravi Srivastava, who works on labor issues, you know, I talked about labor laws and so on. He said much more than anything else, what is broken down and which we will bear the consequences of for a generation is the trust of the poor. We were exploiting them. They knew that. But they believe that when we are in a deep crisis, the state, the government, and our employers will stand with us. And what we demonstrated was the moment the crisis came, we threw them to the wolves and we didn't care what happened to them. And we ensconced ourselves into protection and privilege.
Harshmandir, that is a searing indictment. And I'm completely sure that in many ways it's a deserved indictment of India's middle class, of our attitude to our poor, who are, by the way, our fellow citizens. You're holding up a mirror to our society as reflected by our behavior during the lockdown. I don't think what you're saying will be popular with large numbers who watch this interview, but I do believe that what you're saying is something they should hear, they should listen to, and reflect upon. Thank you very much for this interview. Take care, stay safe, and stay out of hospital.